Random House Audio presents Love is the Best Medicine. What two dogs taught one veterinarian about hope, humility, and everyday miracles. By Dr. Nick Trout. Read for you by Jonathan Cowley. Author's note. 30 years ago, as a wide-eyed, dumbstruck teenager, I helped resuscitate a lifeless newborn puppy, rudely dispatched into this world via caesarean section. For me, it was a pivotal event, an awakening, igniting a dream and ultimately a career as a veterinarian. Decades later, I can still be floored by the surge of excitement that struck me back then. Sometimes it can be brazen, like the fist-pumping thrill of deciphering a mysterious ailment. Sometimes it can be subtle, hidden behind a secret smile as you watch a reunion between an old man and his four-legged companion from afar. No matter what form it takes, veterinary medicine casts a spell, and I was hooked long ago. I love that whenever I least expect it, I will feel the familiar buzz that reminds me there is something magical about healing sick animals. In the 21st century, veterinarians can offer our pets advances in healthcare no less than, and in some instances, more cutting edge than our own. Forget about your garden variety joint replacements and kidney transplants. I'm talking about gene therapy, stem cell treatment, and anti-cancer vaccines. This is happening right now, and the scientific breakthroughs that make it all possible demand our understanding and respect. At veterinary school, we become indoctrinated in the church of the scientific method, accepting the gospel according to rational thought and proven data. There is always a logical explanation. Serendipity has no place in our daily skirmish between life and death. Like so many of my brethren, I drank the Kool-Aid, believed in this philosophy, but as soon as I graduated, I woke up in the real world of medical ambiguity, everyday miracles, everyday heartbreak, and the kind of life lessons that don't come with a lecture and a handout. In my first book, Tell Me Where It Hurts, I tried to capture the pace, the rush, and the impact of all that is new in veterinary medicine, putting the reader on my side of the examination table, sharing the struggles and the joys of trying to heal animals. More importantly, I hope to convey one simple and prevailing truth, that for all the fancy technology and medical advances, what endures and what will always matter most is the intensity of the relationship between human and animal. We can label the emotional connection between pet and owner with an inadequate and cold phrase like bond, but for those of us humbled by the awesome responsibility of trying to keep the connection alive, perhaps we should call it as we see it. Fundamentally, our professional goal is to repair and sustain mutual love. Most of what follows is my attempt to document the undeniable strength of this love, to discover what makes it tick, and to reveal everything you will not find in veterinary textbooks through my encounters with some extraordinary humans and animals over a 2-year period. These pet owners were kind enough to take me beyond the dispassionate detail of a pertinent clinical history and reveal another side to their stories, helping me comprehend the intensity of the relationship they want me to restore. Their insight serves as a reminder that, for the most part, pet and owner come as a package deal, and the privilege of rendering care for animals has consequences far beyond the physical limitations of an ailing body covered in fur, feathers, or scales. At the heart of this book are the true stories of two animals, Helen and Cleo, and their remarkable humans. Read on, and you will appreciate that I am not playing favorites. There have been many easier cases to recount, tougher diseases sent packing, and successes that had me smiling for days. But I dare you to search your memories, filter for what really lingers, and come up with anything other than the highest highs and the lowest lows. These stories intersect at one point. From entirely different worlds, their paths crossed because, independently, they sought medical attention from one veterinarian who happened to be me. Thankfully, though I may be integral to the plot, mine is at most a supporting role. The real stars of the show are easy to spot. Where possible, I have tried to maintain the chronology of the major events, my memory supplemented by medical records, interviews with colleagues, emails, letters, telephone and face-to-face conversations with owners. In many instances, I describe pertinent background and events surrounding these stories, based upon facts and the emotional circumstances as they were conveyed to me. This was never meant to be a commissioned biography, and as such it is influenced by my interpretation, taking the liberty to make inferences, to fill in the gaps with educated guesses, to envisage unrecorded conversations, all the while striving to build a story true to the essence and integrity of my characters, those on two legs and on four. In some cases, the names of pets, owners, and veterinarians and any particular identifiers have been changed to ensure anonymity. In others, real identities remain. If life's journey is a continuous education and everything happens for a reason, then this is my attempt to share some of what I have learned. Over the years, I have come to appreciate how animals enter our lives prepared to teach, and far from being burdened with an inability to speak, they have many different ways to communicate. It is up to us to listen more than hear, to look into more than past. What passes for understanding requires commitment, patience, and granted, an occasional leap of faith. But every so often, even the cynic can decipher our pet's messages and appreciate a simple, yet indelible message. For me, these particular cases spoke loud and clear, giving me an unforgettable lesson in hope, generosity, and the incredible capacity for humans and animals to open their hearts to each other. Chapter 1. Helen. Inside the restaurant, they were just an ordinary couple, enjoying their dinner, comfortable with the lulls in conversation that define a successful relationship. Yet Ben was tuned into everything unsaid, to the waves of distraction playing over Eileen's face, her refuge in the safety of neutral topics. His latest commission, an upcoming exhibition in California, the antics of their beloved Newfoundland dog, Dee Dee, patiently waiting for them to come home. He knew what was really on Eileen's mind, but at this stage in their marriage, he had learned his wife would talk about her troubles when the time was right. Outside the restaurant, there was a creature waiting in the shadows. Historically, only certain humans, the kind with food, were of any interest to this animal, and like most of her species, she relied heavily on olfactory guidance to pick her targets. But on this bitter, cloudless night, refrigerated air would have forced her to trust to visual cues, searching for victims with a friendly, receptive demeanor and preferably carrying a doggy bag. An elderly husband and wife shuffled toward a frosty white Cadillac like a couple of emperor penguins. By any standard, they looked approachable, likely to be sympathetic, and there was that all-important polystyrene container in hand. Then the woman spoke, and the shrill and relentless pitch of her voice forced the creature to back off, the tirade fueled by an inattentive waitress, stale bread, and overpriced entrees, the woman's husband distracted and happy to grunt in agreement, his index finger working some meaty detritus trapped between difficult-to-reach molars. Next up was a gaggle of 20-something women, laughing and shouting, pitching back and forth, alcohol, high heels, and black ice adding to their amusement as they staggered across slippery asphalt arm in arm, five abreast. No doubt they were getting in practice for next month's office Christmas party. Only one of these Spice Girls kept a straight face, and fortunately she was the one fumbling for a set of car keys. There was a man overdressed in a suit and tie, out of place with an attractive woman in blue jeans, the two awkward together in the open raw darkness. She stood upright, feet together, hugging herself, drum tight, impervious to his forced small talk, his rehearsed prelude to plucking up his courage and leaning forward, hoping for a kiss, as she read the move and delivered a polite smile while extending a weak hand to shake. The moment said it all. Thanks, but no thanks. Another blind date disaster, another phone number for her to screen on her caller ID. The guy headed toward the pickup truck had encountered the creature before, and perhaps it was recognition that had her edging out of the shadows, until he opened the passenger side door and a stream of curses exploded in the frigid night air. The words were meaningless to her, but their volume, clipped intonation, and vehemence packed a punch. His ice scraper was no longer in the glove compartment where he thought he had left it, forcing him to pull on the cuff of his lumberjack shirt and scour a hole through the gathering frost on his windshield. And then there were Ben and Eileen, headed for a small SUV in the farthest corner of the lot. Despite the absence of a doggy bag, their body language sent all the right signals. They walked slowly, his arm around her shoulder, his head floating a foot above hers, angled down, a big hand visible and offering a reassuring squeeze. "You've gone all quiet on me," said Ben. "You're okay?" Eileen looked up and worked on forcing a smile into her voice. "I'm good," she said, and added, "I was just thinking about Helen. I'm going to miss her, you know." Ben nodded, but kept quiet, watching her find the words. "I mean, it's not as if she didn't have a wonderful life. 92 years old, 3 children, 9 grandchildren, 21 great-grandchildren. Independent, determined, and opinionated until the end, and she gets to die peacefully in her sleep. What more could anyone ask for?" Ben pursed his lips, keeping in step with her deliberate, short stride, surprised they had never gotten to this when he was eating his main course of homemade gnocchi. He had come prepared to discuss the death of Eileen's last living grandparent, Helen, to defend the inevitability and unpredictability of loss, the way it can summon injustice and anger as it clings to those left behind. But he could clearly see the only emotion welling up in his wife's big blue eyes was sadness. "Your grandmother was a great lady, and if Ma taught me anything..." Ben stretched out the A like a lifelong Red Sox fan from South Boston. "It would be not to go all mawkish over her passing. Let's not forget, Helen was the matriarch who nurtured 3 generations of unruly boys with the line, 'Don't come crying to me when you're dead.'" Eileen began to laugh, the uninhibited laughter of vulnerability and relief. "You're absolutely right," she said, hearing Helen's familiar scratchy voice fade away inside her head. She looked up at her husband, loving him for his gift of always finding the right words and the satisfaction written all over his face for having done so. "Thanks. And thanks again for dinner. It was great." "You're very welcome," said Ben, pecking her on the cheek before breaking away and pressing the key fob, lights on the Toyota RAV4 blinking in anticipation of their arrival. Ever the gentleman, he came around to the passenger side and opened the door. He had time to squeeze in a theatrical bow and sweeping hand gesture before releasing a loud involuntary screech as something small and black entered his peripheral vision from the left, moving at high speed and headed directly for his wife. Sometime later, he would try to defend his emasculated reaction, blaming the poor lighting, the moonless night, the absence of street lamps, his myopia and need for a new contact prescription. He would reference his childhood fear of bears, his fleeting impression of a stealthy, possibly rabid beast, its velocity smacking of focus, target and intent to harm. Finally, he would claim that the controlled scream was his best attempt at offering his wife some kind of warning, given all of these limitations. "It's just a dog," said Eileen, squatting down to initiate a proper greeting without hesitation. "What did you think it was?" Releasing a breathy, "Jesus Christ," Ben disengaged his flattened body from the car's hood. "I just saw this black thing coming out of nowhere," he said, moving closer. Eileen appeared not to hear him, focused on comforting the trembling ball of fur at her feet. The dog had homed in like a heat-seeking missile, squirming around her shins in a tail-wagging, butt-wiggling frenzy of excitement, going turbocharged with the apparent ecstasy of human contact. As soon as Eileen bent down to pet her, she could feel the uneven curly knots of fur, clumps of matted, congealed hair hanging from her body, gritty, greasy dirt leaping onto Eileen's fingertips. The dog flipped over, onto her back, big front paws limp, back legs splayed, relaxed, praying for a belly rub or scratch in a difficult-to-reach armpit, and as Eileen obliged, the dog's eyes closed and her teeth began to chatter, as if she was saying, "Thank you," in Morse code.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.